people my age or like younger people, you know, younger generation thinks they can do everything, especially in development. That main topic today, development, is you need experience. You need those experienced guys to make sure that your products are, you know, well handled. You know, it's easier to make a product, but it's hard to handle it later.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Bloomex Podcast. Thank you again for MCRO for sponsoring this episode. You guys have been doing a great job on continuing to support us in the community we're trying to build. MCRO, if you guys are ever looking for any programming help, building apps, software, definitely hit them up. They're super responsive, LinkedIn, and other channels. And also, again, thank you for Huddle for having us here at this beautiful space and filming out of the conference room. Shout out to you guys. Okay, we're here with Archit.
Yeah.
Archit, man, I'm really happy to have you here. When we launched our first event, the startup stand-up, I mean, we got in contact because you just literally bought a sponsorship package.
Yeah, exactly.
And, funny enough, funny story, like when we put up a stand-up, I mean, Huddle ShareSpace helped us out, and we weren't planning on having sponsors, so we kind of put up the sponsor package there, like as like a test to be like how it looked like, and not thinking that we're going to have to sell this at an event.
Yeah.
But you came out here and you supported us by buying.
I ended up finding it. Perfect, right?
Right, and you came down and we had a blast, right? Yeah. You've seen the promo video we have on the startup page. You're in there.
I was in there a couple of times, actually.
Right, so thank you for that.
Thank you, no problem.
In that kind of regard, I mean, you moved here recently from Chicago, back home.
Yep.
You're originally from the Toronto region.
Well, I was in India for 16 years, since I was born till 16 years.
Okay.
And then, you know, I came here, did my high school, went to Chicago back for a little bit, and then maybe came back, you know, for university, finished university, started working full time.
Cool.
Yeah.
So you did university, sorry, you did here?
I did over here, Ryerson.
Ryerson,
yeah.
Okay. What did you do graduate?
I think about a year and a half ago now.
Year and a half ago now?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's hard to remember the month sometimes.
Definitely.
True.
So you went to college, how long were you in Chicago? This is what one of the things I want to talk
7
about.
Or 8 months, actually.
7 or 8 months?
Yeah, my uncle still lives there. We live in Naperville, not Chicago. It's close by.
Okay.
But Naperville is close by.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how was that experience like? What did you go there for?
It's different. I mean, we have clients there, right?
Yeah.
For the company that I'm going to be talking about, obviously, we have clients there. So I was mostly on like client visits, and you know, we didn't get to actually, you know, get live there, but I was working most of the time.
Yeah.
And then I came back. It was like an internship, you could say that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so I got first introduced to what's going on in Chicago, like pretty much the startup scene there, especially with a lot of media agencies there, through Shopify. So I actually interviewed at Shopify for like a mid-level role there. And part of that interview, they were telling me about Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, you would have to spend a lot of time there.
Yeah.
I already spent a lot of time actually traveling. Yeah. It's a global role.
True.
It would have been cool. It ended up working out, but it didn't. But in Chicago, they're like a bunch of ad agencies connecting globally and we're operating out of there.
Yeah.
Right? Like, did you have
there's actually a BCE summit that comes up every year.
What's it called?
That only BCE summit.
Okay.
That's actually one of the biggest tech summits ever that happens down there. That's one of the main things I was there for. You know, like my goal is to get leads from anywhere I can.
Yeah.
Right. And most of the people that come out and are like enthusiastic to talk about their businesses, I love to have conversations with them. I've had like 2 hours conversations and still not ended up getting the lead, but you know, it's the thought that counts.
Yeah.
Right. So yeah.
So the cool thing about you is you just before we started, like, described yourself as a business development rep. Without naming the company, because it's almost like you fulfill, this is my role, this is what I do, in the field that I am, and the companies or companies you work for is just utility, right? Like, it's just the service provider
exactly.
that you're working for.
So yeah, like you could call me a vendor. People like to say that because
you're a vendor.
You know, yeah, because sitting out in India, for any company to reach out to clients here or even try to get clients here, one of the hardest thing. That's that's what I've heard for years.
Yeah.
So based on that, I built this model that, you know, I go to events for you, you know, I represent you as in your company and I get you leads. I follow up with them for you, set up the calls, you know, and then you close them, obviously, the last step.
So how does that look like? I mean, So the problem with outsourcing in general has a bad name.
Yeah.
But India has a bad name.
Definitely.
Right? Because a lot of like bad players, things have happened. Not even bad players. Even like my previous employer, right, was an energy company we work with. They ended up hiring someone for their portal system to run their CRM.
Yeah.
That person was local, outsourced a person local who then outsourced someone in India. Right, to get the project done.
Makes sense, yeah.
And because it's like a three-way kind of tier, one person has to communicate each layer down.
Yeah.
The top layer doesn't know the bottom layer exists. Yeah. And the communication, just like the
drops out. Ideas drop out, you know, scope creep. And
there you go.
Yeah.
You already have terms for this.
Definitely.
Yeah.
You know, it's very important to know what a scope creep is. I'm sure I'm going to talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
What you're saying is, I mean, obviously India has a bad name and, you know,
outsourcing. I wouldn't say a bad name.
Yeah.
Like, it has a bad name like that. It's just like, you've heard so many stories.
The stories, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I was going to get there. It's the stories. It's experiences that people have had in the past. Thing is, I'll tell you something that not a lot of people like to tell that, hey, my development team is so good that, you know, they are based out of India because they're afraid of the, you know, the myth that, hey, outsourcing company is bad. Yeah. But then, you know, again, you have to know who you're getting into business with, right? If you can't trust the guy on the other side, like you said, the three-way story, if you don't even know the bottom layer, you won't actually be very happy with the product because you know it's outsourced, right? I think we eradicated that problem. Okay. I just talked about scope creep. That happens a lot. Scope is basically what you plan on making, like if you're making like an app or something. You know, scope creep would be missing
process.
Out. Yeah, it would be missing out all those points when you're getting down the communication line. You would be missing out the points. We eradicated that scope creep problem because, you know, we give you one developer that you talk to directly, and there's no communication in the middle. Like, there's no communicator in the middle, if you may. So I think that's one of the main things.
Let's dive into that, right? Because one thing I wanted to add is, like, I hate that process.
Yeah.
So I've done scopes a lot. Starting from my first time I created a digital product, a company called Mappian, right? Had no idea how to do anything in tech, right? And the idea of building a scope was such a momentous task for me.
Exactly.
Because every time I learn something new about one part of it, it opened up 10 more questions.
Yep.
It spirals into a document. Mm-hmm. Right. So you talk about eliminate the scope creep.
Scope creep in a sense that ideas don't get dropped. It's different. There's two types of scope creep, actually. One would be when your idea is not being getting there, or maybe sometimes, you know, we have that problem that the client actually wants more than what they have in the scope. That's a reverse scope creep. Both happen, but the one that sucks the most is the one that's not handleable, when the ideas are lost in the middle, in the transition, right? Yeah. Because your company is not here. If your guy is in front of you, I mean, I could tell you anything right now, you would remember it more than we were on the phone, right?
I mean, scopes are pretty much a project managing tool.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. An artifact you create.
It's more like a document.
Yeah,
I would say that's definitely one of the biggest documents that we work with. I mean, definitely in the technology space, we have scopes for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I like to use the term artifact because it's like it's something you make jointly, almost like with that party together, you're coming together and working is understanding that this is a
my
baseline
requirements
exactly. of what you're creating.
Yeah.
Once it's created, it kind of gets locked into place and we're operating.
Exactly.
And anything that you need to add in, you need to be formally added in. That's essentially, it's like almost like a social contract, but a technical contract.
Exactly.
Right, on what you're...
Like the minimum requirement, and then, you know, you can add it. That's, again, that's not a bad thing for us, especially being the provider. If you're adding stuff, then we're making more money, obviously. So people like to lock it more down during the scope, when you're making the scope with the company, and then, you know, they more usually don't like adding on.
I mean, so a lot of people who are not familiar with scoping, right, get very uncomfortable with it.
Yeah.
How do you help out with that?
Actually, we have people in our company who help build scopes. Not only are we doing the work, we're also building the scopes with you.
Part of a discovery.
Part of the discovery, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a charge for it,
of course.
But then, you know, you're getting someone more professional to think further than what you think. If you're making an app, you're probably going to be like, this is how it's going to look like in my mind.
Yeah.
But there's more to it. I'm pretty sure you're going to need that app to do more.
So have you ever experienced a problem when the client says one thing but doesn't understand what they're asking
every
for?
Day. Literally every day. You know, I used to work for website development. I think I told you this. Even now that when I make websites, same problem. Any technical company, any technology company has a problem with scopes every day. You know, we have clients who don't understand what it means to, you know, scope out the problems. They think everything is okay. I'll tell them just to keep my business. They'll probably do my thing just because it's extra. They won't charge me. But again, you have to make that clear from the beginning that this is what you're locking down with me. But again, it's communication you have to make. You can't just win the client and then have him get back at you because you didn't scope it out properly. Right?
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the frustrating parts too is not just, it's a speed also, right? Like, I remember when the first time I did it, like, I treated the outsourced team as like it was my team, where it's like, oh, cool, new direction, guys. We actually want to add this thing in. Mm-hmm. Actually, never mind for this part, right? Like, you want to be iterative, right?
Yeah.
You want to move fast.
Definitely.
And, like, change up at things. But then it's like, hold on, we got to scope this in.
Exactly.
What exactly is it? Yeah. You got to put it into place. And then by the time the idea might evolve, one of the issues with outsourcing outside of a firm, right? Like, do you know the guy called, I talk about a lot, Naval Ravikant?
I've heard of him from you, actually, but I don't remember exactly.
Maybe we talked about this. So I love mentioning this guy a lot because co-founder of AngelList, he put it to the point a lot, but there's also another writer, Dan Sullivan, wrote about this too.
I've heard of Dan
Sullivan.
He's pretty famous.
He wrote the book called The Firm, I think, talk about the nature of the firm, where why companies keep things internal, they hire people internally, even though it might be more expensive.
Yeah.
To house them internally, pay for all the rent, pay for all the stuff, rather than outsource something to a different entity, whether it be a contract worker or a different company.
Mm-hmm.
It's literally a formula, right? Almost like, you know, like,
I think so.
Why do you come into this barrier versus stay outside the barrier and transact? And the formula comes down to a lot of different variables, but also transactability, trust, the ability to securitize things, and the list goes on, right? But part of that list is also the ability to be agile and work.
Mm-hmm.
If you come and work for me within my company, I pay you such a salary, such hours. I know exactly what I can ask from you and be agile about it.
Yeah.
I can take on the loss of saying, okay, the past 40 hours or 400 hours I paid for you, it's not going to be worth anything. We're going to write that up. We're willing as a company to put that away and say, the next 3 months, you're working on this.
I mean, you can track their hours more too in front of you.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, it's easier to track their hours if you're not working with somebody who's honest, right? Like, I mean, people get paid for 40 hours every day, but they just don't do 40 hours at all a week. I think there is a gap there. The firm you said the book was?
Yeah, no, right? I don't remember what the book is called.
Yeah.
He wrote like a series of three books over 3 decades.
Okay.
All about the nature of the firm. That's what he called it, right?
Yeah.
Why do companies, what forms, what goes in a company versus what you buy, right? What you pay another company to do.
True.
Or another person to do externally. What caused you to bring it the resource internally?
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, the point goes into being, like, for the past few decades, it's really been outsourcing or contracting somebody or moving things outside the firm has been a cost for production kind of point of view.
Yeah,
it's cost dramatically less, so I'm willing to take the risk. You know, I mean, not working out the way I want it to be. Yep. I'm willing to take on the risk of it not coming out the way I want it to be. Or, you know, I'm letting it go.
Again, you gotta trust the people on the other side for that, right?
Yeah.
I think it's easier to just fall in the trap and hire somebody who says he can do it, and you haven't met them in India.
A lot of companies do.
Exactly.
That's
why I'm here. That's why I'm here in the middle. Let's just say my company that we're gonna be talking about soon. If I get somebody hired in, let's say from India, outsourced in India, the guy over here, the client, still has me to like make sure that his stuff is running well, right? They have some kind of establishment here. That's what we wanted to do. We could have looked for clients from just India, you know. That's not a bad idea. Just PPC campaigns you can run, get clients.
People want to see a face.
I'm here, I talk to you maybe half an hour, know this guy. If something goes wrong, I have Archit here. Just to make sure, you know, that scope creep happens. What do I do? Just call Archit, you know?
Yeah.
And then I could probably talk to the CEO and, you know, escalate stuff.
Yeah.
That's one of the main issues too. People don't know how to escalate stuff when they're outsourcing.
Mm.
You made that easier too, because I'm here.
Yeah.
Right? I'm right in front of you.
Yeah. I mean, the next wave, I think what's really happening to reconnect us is, instead of being it's a cost per production kind of issue where it's like the cost is lower, the technology is making it more transactable.
Yeah.
The process is more clear and transparent, right?
Yeah.
Look just how like a live updating document, right?
Mm-hmm.
You, the client, plus one can work on one document and see it update in real time rather than sending PDFs to each other,
yeah.
right? I mean,
yeah.
just technology allows for better transparency and trust to form, yep. like you said, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's all about business, about trust. Exactly. You want to know who you're working with.
At least the guy you're working with should be trustable.
Yeah. Right. But like part of that is being able to see the person in face to face, you know, shaking their hand. And it's always been an old school tactic of business.
Yep.
But technology has also provided a way to verify outside of just physical, mm-hmm. the physical, right? Like okay. you guys utilize any technology mm-hmm. in better communication with the client? Like
we mostly do Skype. And Basecamp. Basecamp is actually project management software.
Okay.
Right?
Is it like a SaaS company or is it?
No, it's Agile. Mm-hmm. It's I forgot the name of the maker for Basecamp. That's what we use, you know, a lot of the times.
Yeah.
There's also, you know, just Skype communication or making sure that the guy is available during the hours that you hire him.
Yeah.
You know, if you hire a developer, let's say any .NET developer, for example, for 8 hours a day, working 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. India time. You just want to make sure you always have somebody available on the other side to make sure that, you know, that guy's working on your stuff in that time.
Yeah.
Right? So I guess that's what we mostly use for communication.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, communication's only going to be effective if you can trust the guy on the other side that he's going to do what you say he's going to do, right?
No, definitely.
So yeah. So we came across hurdles there, but I think we're past them. 11 years into the company, I think we're okay.
Cool.
Yeah.
I mean, what I'm interested in knowing is like workspaces, like the idea of digital online workspaces, right? Like, I mean, it used to be G Suite or shared drives or something like that, where people can access documents back and forth, allowed like people to visually see what's going on, that kind of stuff. But the idea of the shared workspaces, right? Like the companies, everyone from crypto to like more traditional software companies where they're talking about how multiple companies can work
together on the same thing.
Yeah, because they're working usually on the same technology
There's
stack.
There's also another example that a really good point is Jira. It's a ticketing software that a lot of the companies using. I think for the last 4 or 5 years, a lot of the companies are turning towards Jira. Because all conversations can be tracked on the same ticket, you can say that, and multiple people can work on it. People can be from different companies working on the same ticket until it's closed, resolved, or, you know.
Okay.
That's one of the main things that people are working with now.
Amazing. Like I was thinking about this before, right? Like how, like especially with blockchain, I was really into it like 2 years ago, going into a deep dive.
Yeah.
Like how the technology being utilized to better transact between multiple parties, right? Because like, Dan Sullivan really hit the nail on like, if you can decrease the need for the structure where companies have to form large entities, which we see now. A lot of companies are running way more lean than ever before.
Yeah,
Because of power technology. Power technology made it easier to like, okay, few people can do more, therefore the majority of people we can just hire out as needed.
But again, experience. You need experienced people to do more, right? I think, people my age or like younger people, you know, younger generation thinks they can do everything, especially in development. That main topic today, development, is you need experience. You need those experienced guys to make sure that your products are, you know, well handled. You know, it's easier to make a product, but it's hard to handle it later. So again, if you hire somebody that can do more, they say they can do more, you need that guy to have experience. I think we also went over that hurdle. How developers here have maybe 5 years of experience. They're taking $50-$60 an hour. I mean, it's reasonable for in the development space. For $60 an hour in Canada is nothing, and because you know the languages are so vast, or you know the languages are that they want to be using, like React Native, so hard to use, right? So you need that guy to have experience. It's easier to get experienced guys outsourced. I'll tell you that much.
Yeah.
The same if you're paying $50-$60 an hour to a 5 year experienced guy. I can bet you we can get you maybe 13 years of experience guy for the same price, right? So I think he can do way more to make your point, right? Smaller teams, more companies are getting lean so that, you know, they don't have to spend much on these resources, you can call them.
Yeah.
Right? So again, to your point, experience is needed.
Absolutely. Right? And I mean, India's tech culture is blowing up. Like I've been watching, I've been following a lot on like LinkedIn, yes, but on Instagram, right? I really want to go down there and check it out. Like, how's that looking there? How's India, how's that culture there?
The work culture, are you talking about?
Yeah, the work, they have their own tech community, right?
Yeah,
like, exactly. Their own startup community.
Yeah.
Like, India's like the IATs.
Yeah.
I've gotten so much fame.
Exactly.
After now, like, what is it now? Microsoft CEO.
Microsoft CEO. I think Google CEO.
Google CEO.
Says Sundar Pichai.
Sundar Pichai.
Yeah.
Right, and a new one now. Somebody else has recently came on, right, from an IIT as well.
Yeah.
I can't remember right now, but.
Biggest example against Google CEO, mm-hmm. Sundar Pichai, he's from India.
Yeah.
And he's been working for Google forever. And yeah. I think he's obviously now the CEO.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
So that's what I mean. So like, what I'm trying to understand is like from someone who's from India, like mm-hmm. trying to explain to a more yeah. Canadian audience.
Yeah.
Like, how is India different from here mm-hmm. in the way they train for the tech staff?
Okay. I'll start with education.
Yeah.
The education in India might be cheaper than here for mm-hmm. sure, but the stuff they teach you, you just mentioned IIT, did you?
Yeah.
Right? The stuff they teach at IIT, nowhere from like the Waterloo kids here that learn the same thing might not be even half as smart as these IIT kids. So the education itself matters a lot, right? My own cousins went to IIT. They're like 6 years younger than me, probably smarter than me.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm not afraid to say that because education plays such a huge part in what you become when you're trying to get hired for a company working in Canada, right? Because I think here it's more, it's more subtle, and I think it's easier to work a good working environment. Over there, there's so much competition. I mean, there's 1.9 billion people there, right?
Yeah.
So you have to make sure that you're up and over those people, you know, just to get hired at a better company.
Yeah, competition's always been a factor.
Yeah,
right?
So starting with education, for sure, I mean, the education there is so much better. I wish I got educated in India, by the way. I realize that now because, I went to Ryerson here, I did pretty good. But again, if I went to IIT, it would be completely different. I would be 10 times as smarter,
yeah.
Right? And not only because it's just people are born that way, it's nothing like that.
Yeah.
It's the principles that they're teaching. Because if you have a bigger crowd that you have to make sure you get brilliant thinkers out of, you have to make sure that the education's that level.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's there in India for sure. And coming to work, I think everybody in India is following the same principles, slowly, that US and Canada, UK, bigger countries are following. Like Agile, same exact workspace. Jira is actually American mm-hmm. product. India is one of the biggest user for Jira as a help desk system, right? There's also products like Office 365, you know? The biggest market for those products is in India.
Yeah.
Not only the market for users, the developers that can do stuff on Office 365, it's crazy,
yeah.
Right? So there's more startups there. I think nobody in India can be considered poor at
yeah.
all. Because again, coming to the money, they're making a lot of money for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, they're able to pay, tons of developers even at our company. We started about 11 years ago. Now today we're easily able to pay all these developers because there's so much business, right? There's 1.8 billion people. If out of that half a billion become tech savvy, there's a huge growing community,
absolutely.
Right?
And India just became the fifth largest economy in the world.
Exactly.
Beat up France.
Yeah.
Right, like, crazy. I mean, are you big in history at all? Like,
kind of, yeah, you can say that.
So I've been recently getting into a lot of Indian history,
yeah.
Especially understanding the culture, the differences there, and how it all kind of formed.
Yeah.
I know, being Sri Lankan myself.
Oh, Indian history, I would be pretty good, for sure.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, I've been trying to look into the different, like how colonization happened, right? Like
mm-hmm.
how India as a fractured nation was slowly taken over.
Rebuilt, exactly.
Until all these kind of things happened, and
yeah.
how that drastically affected it.
Yeah.
There was a MP of, what was his name? Thapur, Satish Thapur. He's an MP of Kerala.
Okay.
He did a talk. He really what sparked my interest. A few years ago, he did a speech at Oxford University.
Mm-hmm.
They were asked to. The speech topic was how did British India help India?
Right? How did British India help India?
Yeah.
Okay.
How did the British yeah. help India? Right.
I have a very good answer for that, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the talk was basically centered upon mostly on education.
Mm-hmm.
And as a debate speaker, one person came up and told about all the things that the legacy was left behind.
Mm-hmm.
And then this guy came and gave the biggest ripping into it mm-hmm. of some economic data of how not only the resources drained out of India, but it was systematically cut off. Like people could definitely cut
off. They couldn't grow. I mean, in the British India, I think until 1947, mm-hmm. we were ruled by the British. And they just didn't let us grow. I mean, I don't want to say this too out loud. I think it could have been better. India would have been much better as a country if they weren't ruled. But again, things happen for a reason. If you think about it, US has had about 25 presidents, right? Something like that. Trump is like the 25th one now. Mm-hmm. India has only had half of that. I'll tell you why. Because US has been, US is a developed country, of course. Yeah. The reason it's like that is because 200 years it's been since US was freed up.
Yeah.
So India?
Dale, can you fact check that? How many presidents have there been in the US? Just Google that?
I just heard 21st president was Franklin or something.
Okay.
But I mean, it's in the 20s for sure.
Yeah.
I guarantee I'm going to check
but
that.
But India
has had much less. I'll tell you why. Because it's only been 7 years.
Yeah, of course.
Since we got our independence.
Yeah, yeah.
Imagine India at this rate. I mean, yeah, population's a factor.
I mean, it was. India also had one of the biggest economies in the
exactly.
world.
Exactly.
So pre-colonization.
I mean, not just that. I think it's also the fact that India could have grown more without the British. How many?
45.
Oh, 45. That's way too much. Never mind.
Yeah.
Say 45 for like 200 years.
Old.
Exactly.
They're 300 years old.
Yeah. So now we're only 70. India, by the time we're 200 years old, we're off the charts, literally. I'm telling you, all these myths are going to go away. I know. I don't think this. I know this. All these myths are going to go away.
I believe so, too.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been like, this whole pro-India movement is happening right now. There's a lot of nationalism happening in India. And part of that is leading to a lot of research.
Mm-hmm.
It's opening up a lot of research into what India's past was, pre-colonization.
Yep.
I mean, the government's fear because it's such a new nation and so many different people, 1.8 billion people, so many different cultures.
Exactly.
Because let's not look back because then people might remember these be independent and want independence.
Yeah.
Right? Like Bangladesh and like Pakistan and all these issues.
Yep.
So it's always been like, let's create a monoculture. Let's create a new India. India's new. It's only 30 years old. It's new.
Mm-hmm.
And there's almost a push to a race culture. But there's been a shift recently with this rise in like, in self-pride of looking backwards.
Yeah.
And have you been following this at all? Like,
Not exactly, but I do know that we're like the fifth largest economy in the world now. It's crazy, right? I heard it on the radio actually 2-3 days ago.
Yeah, yeah.
It's crazy. I mean, sure you can track back some of the excellence that came. It could have been the British because, you know, they left a lot of their mannerisms. The English that Indian people use is a lot different than Canadian. Actually, no, not that different than Canadian because we're still ruled by the UK. But American English is more perfect than Indian English. But again, Indian English is coming from UK. You have to understand that there's a different origin. So again, British, they changed the whole country and the future of it.
Yeah.
But again, you know, we build up, we rebuild on it, right? So. I mean, fifth largest. Who knows? Next year we could have been the first. Could be the first, right?
Yeah. I mean, what do you think? Do you think it's going to be the first India?
Oh yeah. Next year. You never know, right? I mean, we have 1.8 billion people.
Yeah.
If everybody, I mean,
it's the world's largest
democracy. I always think about this. Americans could have so much money, but if the Indian money comes together, 1.8 billion people, we can surpass you easily.
I mean,
India's not in that much debt. I mean, there is debt for sure. India's not in that much debt as the US. You know, fact check, I think trillions of debt is right now in the US.
Yeah.
So that's not a problem for sure.
No, absolutely.
Right? And it's amazing how so many people, and yet we don't have that many problems. I mean, sure, there's problems in every country, but we're doing much better than we thought would be. Right?
No, absolutely. I mean, it's the world's biggest democracy.
Yeah.
How like were you involved politically at all? Like trying to figure it out?
Politics never actually got my
attention.
I think I do. I mean definitely I follow the sports, I follow the religions, I follow the cultures, but the Indian politics never actually got to me. Maybe it's the fact that we did do it in school, we did learn about it in school. It's just never, some things don't nurture right inside you, and you don't get excited about them. Politics is one of them. But I do know that most of the things about the recent facts.
So most recently, like, I've been again following this history, right?
Yeah.
So, do you know anything about like the ancient religions, ancient cultures of the world,
of the world?
Yeah.
Like how from man.
So there was
from six, monkeys, right?
Yeah. Not just that, but there's six cradles of civilization
yeah.
where like the actual nations came from, like actual. like Mesopotamia was like Egypt and like Greece and all that, right? Yeah. But there was another region, like the Indus Valley civilization, right? Where that's where in the Indus Valley region, like, that is a completely different type of civilization came up and spread from there, right?
Yes.
That's the starting point of like India's history.
Yeah.
And that entire region's history, actually.
Yeah.
And recently in like Tamil Nadu, they were, they found a like part of the Harappa civilization that they came out of there. They found a dig there.
Yeah.
10,000 years old.
Yeah.
Right? A city that wasn't buried in time.
Yep.
It's in there, showcasing that there has been an archaeological footprint from that time. For sure. In the region.
Our gods too. You know how many gods Indian people have? I think like more than 200 for sure. But if you, I'm not sure if you know about Shiva.
Yeah.
So there's actually a place in India, it's called Shivling. Mm-hmm. That's where it's said that he used to sit on top of the a mountain down there and actually pray.
Yeah,
so all that history is there for sure, right? That's where we came from for sure. I understand that.
Definitely. I mean, talking about the Hinduism, I feel like it's a revival for the religion almost.
Yeah.
There's a couple, do you know what cyberpunk is?
No, not exactly.
So cyberpunk is like a type of genre of like art. It's big on Instagram. It's like a lot of movies. So like Blade Runner, it's like a cyberpunk.
Cyberpunk. Yeah, I heard of that
kind of film, right? There's a game coming, called Cyberpunk 2077. It's a type of like despotic kind of future where like mixing technology and futurism in like a negative way.
Yeah.
Kind of dystopian, right? But in India, this culture has kind of been shifted and merged together with Hinduism and like the elements from it.
Yeah. The culture, right?
Yeah, part of the culture. A lot of designers there, a lot of artists, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And the new age, the new wave of art coming there from like Indian cyberpunk. I just posted a post on my Instagram, like my stories, of, like a few days ago, right, about this, like a reshare of one, right? And it's crazy, like the old world art is now merging with the new world art, especially in the digital age.
For sure.
And it's coming out.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Like it's a different culture showing its lens into the world, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where we originate from. I mean, right?
Yeah. And I think that's part of it. Like art is a great way of bringing back coming into the world stage, right? So Satish Sapor told us about this. Like India pursues soft power.
India pursues
soft power.
Soft power.
Right? It's like it's not about a hardcore military stance where it's like we have a huge military, you know, where we stand for this.
Yep.
They focus on soft power. Their culture, like Indian dramas now, right? Like they say the Taliban stopped fighting in Afghanistan around the time that this particularly Indian dramas air on their national shows, right?
It's actual, a huge democracy. People do what they want.
Yeah.
Right?
Right? And like the culture has spread so much that the surrounding regions in Asia and Africa has appreciated this. And because of that, people want to transact more with India.
Exactly.
Right? And that's the soft power that's now opening up new lands of opportunity, right, for India. Like,
exactly.
I mean, you understand the North American market. Like, how is it globally? How has India changed globally as a power?
I think tourism makes a huge difference in India's economy and revenue, right? There's a state in India called Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah.
They're actually, no city or like, there's no province in Canada that's actually popularizing people coming and seeing their heritage. India's doing that. Madhya Pradesh and, you know, there's Rajasthan, these two states, there's actually big film stars trying to promote the tourism there. I think that's definitely helped the Indian economy a lot.
Definitely.
Tourists bring in money, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's for sure. Compared to the American market, North American market, like you said, if you're doing it technology-wise, I mean, there's much smarter people here because the experience or like the exposure you get because there's no less competition. But again, the education there has so much of a different impact on these developers or all these tech-savvy people is because there's so many of them.
Yeah.
And the ones that are average over there might be half as much, double as much smart as the people here, right? In the technology space. Again, I mean, it's a developing country, so we're getting there,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
There's gonna be a day that for sure companies are gonna be bigger in India. I mean, there's already big companies and industries in India, but I think it could be bigger as soon as we get a little bit more space to grow, right? I mean, the country is not getting any bigger, it's just population is, maybe that's the problem, but again. You know, China has this brings me, the population fact brings me. China has a limit on how many kids you can have in your house. India doesn't have that yet, right? So maybe that's something that we could implement for sure.
Definitely.
Right?
I mean, cool thing is about like the growth of India, right? As a region, like being the world's largest democracy, now being a technology powerhouse, cultural powerhouse, promoting itself globally. I mean, I think it's changing kind of the landscape of how the East
people look at India. Yeah, exactly.
Not just the India, like the East in general.
Yeah.
Right. And you're right in the way that I think the myths about India are going to change because the old ways of doing things are going to change.
Exactly. I mean, we're adapting, right? 70 years is not much. Maybe about when we're done about 100, it will definitely look different than how it is now.
Yeah. But like, I mean, going back to what you said about like smarter coming out of Indian schools, like 100%, like I really like in the East, like the standards are much bigger, but I think they're still like handicapped by following the old British ways of doing things where it's like study by the book and answer the test for it. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the main criticisms has been with hiring people from India is because it's become so task oriented, like tell me what to do, I'll do it. Or like by the book, the creative element is almost
lacking.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. I mean, you went to school here, so you probably see the difference in that kind of thinking.
I mean, if you think about, when you say creative element, what do you mean exactly?
Creative as in like, I might be wrong here.
Maybe thinking outside the box.
Thinking outside the box, right? I mean, coming like the mentality there being more like, you know, because you go through such a, I guess authoritarian teacher teaches you this, repeat back, listen to the book, repeat back kind of methodology. It's more like subservient almost, right? You go into the workforce looking like, tell me what to do and I'll do it, kind of thing. Whereas here, it's becoming more freeform, where it's like you are independent to, you know, and meant to think at a higher level.
Do you think it's easier to be entrepreneur here than in India?
I think in India has much more. I think it's much.
I mean, quantity wise, we have way more companies and entrepreneurs for sure. I mean, because of the populations. But you think it's easier because of the work ethic or something?
I don't think so. I think the cost of the cost of living is so high. The risk of being an entrepreneur, I think it's an actual formula. I don't know if someone actually figures out yet, but I'm pretty sure it's a formula on risk tolerance. The riskier it is to make like a jump into, make any kind of risky bets
investments,
right? The less people are going to do it.
Yeah.
And I think it's so costly to live here and people get so stuck with debt. North America is very infatuated with debt.
Yeah, definitely.
We're nothing compared to the States.
Yeah,
but still pretty bad.
Yeah, I mean, student loans, right? Yeah. I mean, obviously there's OSAP here to cover you, but again, you have to pay that back. Right? Everyone is drowning in debt. I think even to become an entrepreneur here, I know you have to have your side income actually, or like some kind of income covering your actual expenses, because it's so hard to, you know, and keep investing.
Yeah,
I think businesses here. I know my CEO that I used to work for before, he used to have the biggest problem that he didn't want to invest in his business more. Mm. You know, as a startup or even as a tech company startup, I think if you don't invest, you know, Elon Musk, the Tesla guy, he actually I heard this in one of his videos that if you don't invest in a business early, it's never going to profit enough for you to actually, you know, break the eggs or break the fruit later, because you're always thinking that I put this much money in and it should be producing. It's not like that. You have to keep putting in money to develop the ways that are actually going to, you know, build your business, and then you make money.
Yeah.
So again, you have to be very careful because there's a lot of risk. Like putting in money into something, there's a lot of risk in Canada. Right?
Yeah, I feel so too. Like, what do you think about India versus Canada? You've lived in both places.
Yeah, I think it's harder to get a job here.
Get a job
for
here?
For sure.
Get a job here or entrepreneurship wise?
No, get a job here.
Okay.
Entrepreneurship, I mean, I'm doing so myself. I didn't find it that hard. I mean, you have the resources.
What do you think is better here or India? Or it might not better, but like...
I would say...
Preferable.
Starting affordable wise,
preferable,
India.
Preferable
here.
Yeah.
So much easier. I'll tell you why. Because... if you're working out of India, you can't score a lot of American clients that easily. Mm. It's easier to extend an arm from here, sitting in here to India, I think. It's just my thoughts. It's easier to extend an arm and actually grab a couple of people as a client if you're sitting in Canada or US. What do you think?
Yeah, so preferable. Is your measure of preferable access to the American market?
It is. I mean, sales is everything to me. I'm a sales guy.
Yeah.
Right? So I actually don't going reverse of the myth, Indian people are usually looked to be very stingy with money for some reason.
Yeah.
I don't know where that came from because I'm not like that.
Yeah.
I actually like making more money, right? So I think it's easier to make money sitting here as an entrepreneur than in India because there's so much competition, right? Any company you open, like the work I'm doing here, dedicated resource development, if I was doing that in India, I would have so much competition. People are like, oh, I just heard 2 or 3 days ago, this guy's also doing the same thing. I'm like, oh, crap. Okay, that's fine. I'm better, though.
Yeah.
You know, you got to prove that. Again,
there's
no proving element here. You have people like me who are just looking to expand, you know, expand their businesses. And there's not a lot of us, right? There's not a lot of businesses in Canada compared to India. Of course, there's a lot of businesses in Canada. But compared to India, it's a bigger market. I think you can do much better if you become, also depends on what kind of entrepreneur you're trying to become. If you're just doing an app, it's so much easier to build it out in India, if you're staying in India. But if you're doing an app development company, if you're here, people get so much more business than India. And I've heard real-time stories, like I talk to at least 50 people every day who are entrepreneurs or maybe, you know, like working in a company with me, for me, or against me. I've always heard that you have a life that's easier here. Yeah, sure, expense-wise, you're paying more for everything.
Yeah.
Even a candy costs more in Canada, but you know, you gotta factor in the fact.
Right? My experience with like the development development companies in Canada, Toronto, especially, well, the Toronto ones I have familiar with, but even Canada-wide, is that their market share is shrinking because there's so much competition now here too.
Exactly.
For dev shops.
Yeah, and how many people do we have in Canada?
Right?
40, 50 million, something, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
over there is like,
or,
yeah, 30s, right? Something.
Yeah, 30 million.
So, and there's a billion there.
Yeah.
So comparing wise, for sure.
So, I mean, that's the beauty of an emerging market, right? I mean, you guys are growing so much that even though there's so much competition, the market is growing at a certain speed.
Yeah.
Whereas here, the market is growing, but like very stagnantly, but like we have the infrastructure support, right?
Yeah.
I mean, how is it like infrastructure wise? Like here we have somewhat pretty good established infrastructure for to support entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
We have more things here, but.
Like, you know, we have in Canada, actually, that brings me up, like there's actually regional foundations helping entrepreneurs get money for their businesses. That's not there in India. Nobody's gonna help you. I mean, of course, there's some people who will lend you money or like, you know, who will invest in your business. There's big investors who have money in India, but I think it's easier to get the funding here. Even me, when I was 17 or 18 years old, I had an idea. So I went up to this organization called the Peel Board, not Peel Board, Peel. Registration board or something.
Okay.
They actually helped me. They told me plans on how you can get funding. I said, I'm 18 years old. Mm. How are you gonna get me funding? Nobody's gonna trust me. They're like, no, it's not. It's Canada, boy. I mean, everybody.
True.
If you're an entrepreneur and they see that you're a good influence or like a good person to work with, they don't care about your age.
Yeah.
Right. Most people don't even know my age. How old do you think I am?
I'm not sure, actually.
Exactly.
Deceptive.
It's very, I mean, I'm pretty sure if I give you two guesses, you won't be able to guess it.
Okay, let me get two guesses then.
Yeah. Okay, first one.
Let's call it young. 25?
Close.
24.
Okay.
24.
Shit. That was very close.
My next guess was 35.
Exactly, right?
Yeah.
So, it's the looks and the mind
that's different,
right? So, again, so I think it's easier to become more of a business person here.
Mm-hmm.
Although, I did have a lot of friends in India whose dad are like crazy rich Asians.
Yeah.
And again, that's like from the beginning, they've been doing that. If you're smart, you can make money anywhere. You know, I've made money in India, I've made money here.
Yeah.
It's not a hard thing. It's not rocket science to make money.
I think the criticism has been, I mean, I don't know how accurate this is. I mean, it's more of a question. Again, most of the stuff I'm saying today is not my opinion. It's things I've read about, heard about, criticism is when it comes to the legal system. North America's real asset is the legal system, where we have put priority on it because it was built organically, meant for the community that lived in. Whereas in East, especially India, it was built by again a foreign power that was meant to build it for a certain purpose, its own purposes, and it's been assumed and taken over by a new government, and it's still struggling to figure out how to make it. Accessible and applicable for everybody and actually have power everywhere, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, we take this system for granted, but one of the things we have benefits is being able to use the power of the courts to defend ourselves. So here, because we have that guarantor, aka the government, we're more willing to transact, invest in a business, or do business or all that. But again, the criticism has always been, I've heard the opposite from people in India. It's like, I mean, we don't have a legal system, but it's more about the trust.
Yeah.
It's like, here, you guys ask for paperwork and all these things and signatures there, like, I'll look you in the eye, shake your hand, and we do a deal.
I kid you not, people in India trust each other much more than people in Canada trust each other.
Is it because you have to?
No, I don't think it's because you have to. It's just, okay, so let's just say I'm working for an Indian company right now. If I didn't sign the contract with them, a Canadian company that I could have been working for, they'll take so much advantage of that. Yeah. They'll never pay me the money because I never signed the contract.
Yeah.
But if you're working, they'll make sure that they, you know, make some money out of me or like snatch some money because I don't have a contract. However, if the same company that I'm working with now, I can trust them enough that they would still pay me without any doubt.
Really?
I don't know why, it's just always there. I mean, of course they can break it, but I really don't expect them to.
Do you think it's a more cultural thing?
It is a cultural thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I personally, I love India because, you know, I was there for 16 years. I was just telling somebody on the way here that if I get a chance, I would move to India tomorrow. Not because, you know, I mean, I'm getting there. I'm trying to get successful here. But I think it's a lot more opportunities I can do, right, in India.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. And family too. I mean, my whole family is in India. I just have my mom, dad, and my brother here.
That's a fascinating critique, right? I mean, we here are so obsessed with protecting ourselves.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Even though we have a place that's the most stable. Like, we live in a pretty stable society.
Yeah.
And yet we're obsessed about security and protection, if you think about it.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, was there a culture clash at all when you came here from...
I think so. I mean, I had a very thick accent in the beginning. I was 16, so... I was just getting into the schooling system too.
Yeah.
But again, the culture didn't affect me. I'll tell you why. Because the studies were so different.
Yeah.
It's so much easier. High school was a breeze. I didn't do anything. I used to play ball from right after school till 4 p.m. till 10 p.m. I was playing basketball.
Yeah, yeah.
I have an exam next day. I'm acing them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because I came from India. You know, the stuff that you guys are doing in grade 11 or 12 here has already been taught to me. Maybe in grade 9, actually. The foundation of the education is so much thicker. Or like, you know, so much more stable that...
Which system do you prefer? Like, just because like, do you prefer the Indian system here? Like, do you think that the richness of content?
There's pros and cons in both.
So that's what I'm looking for.
Exactly. I mean, if you study in India, sure, you'll be... I know you will be so much smarter because the content is so massive, right?
Yeah.
They try to fit so much more in your brain. And I think they do it pretty well. I mean, there's good amount of, you know, education schedules that you can follow. Mm-hmm. But here, it's more about what you want to do. Nobody's forcing you to do anything. Mm-hmm. You know that?
Mm-hmm.
In high school, you can have physics, biology, and chemistry all together in the same semester.
Yeah.
In India, you can't do that because you go crazy. Right? Right? There's three major subjects.
Yeah.
But here, I did those three things in the same semester.
Same, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because nobody's stopping you from what you want to do here. So I think, again, it's more freedom-wise better here.
Like, what do you feel about the purpose or the mission of education here versus there? Like, in India, what was the... Like,
everybody wants to be a doctor, engineer,
of course,
or like a lawyer in India. Lawyer's new, by the way. Before, it used to be doctor or engineer, right? I mean, I did engineering because, you know, that's always what I wanted to do. I was into technology ever. But here, the question was that, how do you think is different?
Yeah, preferable sense, it's like, what do you think is the goal of education? Like,
The goal of education here, that's a good question.
Yeah.
That's a very refined question. I think the goal of education here is be who you want to be, right?
Yeah.
They don't stop you. Like, if you, there's actually programs here that even in engineering, first year is common for everybody. And you can switch programs, go to another stream, chemical or computer, anything you want to be. I don't think that option is there in India that option is obviously there because people switch streams all the time, but it's very like judgy, it's system. If you first year you did something different and second year you're trying to do chemical engineering maybe, it's very judgy. Like, people are going to judge you forever. That why did you do that? I know, it's weird, right? Like, but that's the truth.
So what is it, like, you don't belong here because you didn't start from originally? Or no, is it like, just why would you change?
Competition, right? You're losing a year of your life. Mm. And over here, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Right? Here, you're encouraged to take a leap year.
They make you, exactly. They make you do extra courses to improve yourself. Yeah. But in India, it's considered the the worst thing in the world if you're repeating anything.
Yeah.
I think it's because of the culture. It's definitely the Hindu culture, that especially where I'm from. If I did the same grade again, my dad would kick my ass. Literally.
Yeah, yeah.
But again, if I did the same thing here, which I did actually, they made me do grade 10 math again, just to make sure that I get the root basics. I aced it. But in India, that was, if I told people in India that I did that, they'd be like, whoa, why? Bro, is everything okay? Are you like retarded now?
Okay. So
exactly, that's still there, and you can ask any Indian person in the world, they'll say, "Yeah, my mom and dad are gonna kick my ass."
I don't think we're allowed to say those words like that anymore. But
right? It's so much different. I think you can. It's a different goal here for education. Again, the question comes back: if you study here, really nobody cares what you do.
Yeah,
you can do anything you want, and again, that's why entrepreneurship's easy. Because entrepreneurship, I think, is like stepping out of the box. Mm-hmm. It's not thinking anymore, it's stepping out of the box.
So you think the mental framework is provided here allows for entrepreneurship more?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's my point.
Okay.
Yeah. In India, if you are trying to become an engineer, for sure you can do that. You can get a degree in even entrepreneurship, but it won't be the same, or you won't be looked at society the same if you didn't do engineering.
Gotcha. I mean, have you ever seen those memes online with the difference between business, starting a business, being a businessman, businesswoman, versus being an entrepreneur? So it's like the example of, you know, a businessman takes, or businesswoman takes, gets a banana, buys for a dollar, sells for $1.50, makes arbitrage. That's a business.
Entrepreneur makes a shake out of it, sells it for $2.50.
Yeah.
I saw an Instagram post about that.
That being the difference. So do you feel like the entrepreneurship happens here more and business happens more in India?
Again, the creativeness is there, right? So people really love, especially Bluemix too. You guys love thinking outside the box, right? Maybe that's lacking in India. We're still slowly getting there, but there's a little bit lag there, for sure.
I feel like that comes from a place when a certain percentage of the population is comfortable.
Yeah.
In the middle class,
right?
You're comfortable enough to think more at a higher level. I'm not running for substance anymore. But the funny thing is, there's still a large amount of people in India. Like, we think of India and think about people who are poor. There's a lot of people who have historical wealth, land, right?
Like,
property. Like, they've had substantial generations
of money. So much money.
Right? The issue is, the money doesn't float. I think like, there's a lot of generational people, especially culturally, are like, why am I going to fund your thing? Why don't I just build upon my
mindset? Exactly. And I think that, do you think that mindset's here? I don't think so.
No, here's the exact opposite.
Exact opposite. People love investing in other people.
Yeah.
I mean, if obviously the trust is harder to make because there's not a lot of people here. But once they get the trust right, I think they invest in you, right?
And I mean, do you think it's a detriment to culture, to growing up there or just trying to do things? That if you want to get capital in India versus here, have you had experience in this?
Like capital as in money wise?
Yeah, you want to get money to do something, a project or something, right? Yeah. Whether it be a sponsor.
So much easier here.
So much easier.
Again, I told you about York Peel region. These guys have people sponsoring anyone who wants to do business. They don't even look at your age.
What if you wanted to do that in India? Like if you wanted to, I'm going to do this project.
Sure, you can find people. There's much more people. But there's no agencies helping you do that.
So it's no institution.
There's no institution.
It's more people, individuals.
It's more people, individual. Exactly.
Yeah.
So if you know the right amount of people, sure, you can become a huge businessman in India. But you have to make sure that you have you know the right amount of people. Or right people.
Oh, the right people.
Actually. Here it might be easier to find wealth for your business.
Cool, awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, we delved into a lot about India and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I mean, anything else you want to bring up?
Just development.
Let's bring up my site. The company you work at.
Yeah.
So you work a 9-to-5 with the main company, but you also have multiple side projects and side companies you work with.
Yeah.
Right? So let's break it down for us. We talking a lot about the future of work and what it means to be a modern day worker, right? Like, you are wearing multiple hats, multiple things in your LinkedIn happening right now.
Exactly.
Break it down for us.
I mean, sure, we can look up my LinkedIn too, that's there.
Yeah.
But the company that this one is Archisys. My name is Archit, by the way. That's amazing.
I almost thought of your company.
Yeah,
I originally thought of your company.
You know, I told the founder that, I mean, I met him like, what, 6 months ago, 7 months ago?
Yeah.
But I told the founder, thank you so much for naming the company after me.
Yeah.
But they didn't, actually.
Okay.
This, basically, my full-time job,
if great
you, since you started with that, is actually website development. But this is on the side, something I do.
Cool.
This is a company run by dedicated developers. That's our model. I keep talking about that, actually, development, because the reason that...
Dedicated developer is a different kind of methodology.
It's a different, not methodology, I would say it's a model. It's a business model.
Okay.
I'll tell you why. Because, you know, you as a business owner or like a tech company startup owner, you could easily get people over here. But why get people over here for the same price if you can get somebody twice as experienced? Maybe for less price, right? So our model is completely, actually, see, cost-efficient, that dedicated development model where you hire developers dedicated for your time and your skills, right? So based on how you want them to work. IT project, so we have project managers, we have designers, we have developers, all ready to get hired. It's the other way around. We're not looking for developers. We already have a bunch of them. So we're actually getting them hired here.
So do you hire them on salary yourselves and pretty much resource them out?
Or both, actually.
Both models?
So we already have a bunch of developers who are working on projects on the side here, there, within our company. But also we give the clients that I'm trying to get an option to handpick developers, right? So we get them a bunch of resumes that, hey, I mean, it's India, 1.8 billion people. If you put a job posting here, I got told this very recently, if you put a job posting in Canada for a developer, you'll get through two or three like solid resumes for sure. I mean, really good guys. But if you put the same posting in India, you get 100, easily, 100. The reason is because there's so many people, right? So any development language that you work with, we can get you front-end developers, web developers, so Microsoft, that's what I was talking about, Microsoft developer. Can you go there?
Yeah, hire Microsoft?
Yeah. So we have Microsoft developers too. See, I mean,
Microsoft developers mean?
Like C# and ASAP.NET, I should be there. Yeah, C#, ASAP.NET. So these are all basically like Microsoft's own languages.
Yeah, I haven't seen C# in a while, C-sharp, like here. Like,
exactly.
I don't think anyone even trains for that much.
Actually, they do. There's some developers here, for sure. I know some C#
developers.
I'm not
too familiar with the
development space.
The Microsoft ecosystem of development.
Yeah. So again, like obviously they have an operating system which everybody uses. They also have their own language, right? So some of them are these. Another thing that we do is actually software development. So this is for hiring our developers. Can you go to services?
Yeah. So what? If you can name the difference between
what's that?
So
basically,
software developer is you develop an actual product.
Exactly.
Other one is you hire.
It's actually service.
Yeah.
It's a service-based model. So this is actually, let's say, if you're almost done building your app or software, anything like that, we help you do that. So that's our office actually.
Oh, nice.
Archisys, yeah. So we help you do that.
Do you have a giant billboard in front of it?
If we do. We do.
That's insane.
Yeah, sick, right?
Yeah.
So there you go. So that's the dedicated resource model. Not only can you do that, you can also hire us to finish your software. So we'll give you a quote that maybe it's going to take like 2 months. Actually, I recently did a quote. This guy's almost, I signed an NDA, so I can't talk about it much, but this guy's doing something for sexual-oriented diseases. He built the whole software. He's almost done.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of people here. I don't know. It's weird. I meet a lot of people who are almost done their product, but they need help. They need that QA, that testing part to finish up and launch their product.
Yeah,
that's there, we finish that, we do that too. Again, it's very vast. Our model with hiring these developers, again, it doesn't have to be project basis. It could be hourly based too. So if you know, I don't want more than this many hours to be spent on my project, you can decide a rate and actually get that. Or you can just hire for lifetime.
Nice.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So there's like 3 months contract, like 15 months contract, so you can save money on prices. Again, so we built expenses. I'm going to be showing you that too. So
cool.
See, that's a timeline of how Archisys is building products, enterprise solutions. That's our own apps that we built, expenses, just like Archisys. Product engineering, express mobility, enterprise mobility. So, you know, we work with a lot of...
This is a really nice site too, man.
Yeah, it's amazing, right?
Yeah.
It's built in React, I think.
Oh, sure. Nice.
Yeah, maybe it's WordPress or React.
I hate WordPress sites so much.
Yeah.
Because like,
It's very basic.
You're seeing the same thing over and over again. Same kind of typeface.
You know, even WordPress is getting better now.
Yeah,
I'll tell you that much. Yeah,
it is.
So yeah, if you go to solutions, and then expense management.
Yeah, that's the page.
Oh, that's the page. Yeah. Okay, perfect. So yeah,
so on top of the ball.
Expenses is actually one of our, we call it enterprise solution because it's our own app, actually. Yeah. So not only do we work with a lot of elevator companies, I know I'm going to be talking about that too. Expenses is a expense management software. Go down.
Yeah.
So see how companies actually, they always need an expense management software.
Yeah.
So our software actually tracks every single dollar you're putting into your business. And I think that's very important for businesses nowadays because you want to know what you're spending money on, right? You don't want to leak. You don't want to have that leakage there. So that's our software that our app is on App Store. You can check it out. So multi-currency expense manager, you know, it's completely based on hierarchy too. So you can have certain people base or like view your certain types of approvals.
Is this a tax management software?
No, just like expenses. Just under every expense, right? I mean, if you have a business developer, you can, how much you're paying them every month, you can have them, you can upload your, what's it called, invoices here directly. Mm-hmm. And I mean,
so we just think called the Wave accounting, right? So Wave accounting.
There you go, that's expensive right there.
Cool. So Wave is like, you send invoices out to people, you get paid through
I heard about that, yeah.
Right, and then it tracks your income versus,
how much you're putting in, yeah.
It adds the payroll and adds all these kind of things
everything.
To it, right?
Yep.
Is it similar to that or is very it a layer similar. That connects to it?
Very similar, actually maybe even more, right? Because I think we took the negative parts and developed on them too.
Cool.
So that's there.
Perfect. Yeah. So let's wrap up with like the other projects you're working on.
Yeah.
Let's bring up your LinkedIn because you're working on a few things.
Oh yeah, exactly.
Time, right?
I mean, I do three things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's your, is this your full time?
That's my part time. I just started actually.
Okay.
When I came back from Chicago, I started right away. In January 1st was my first day.
So I love seeing this because when we first checked your profile out before we reached out to you after you got the sponsor package for us. You want to go down, Dale? You know, we see like, I'm trying to figure out, okay, who you are and like, you know.
Exactly. These three things are actually what I'm doing. Stop right here. These three things are exactly what I'm doing.
Cool.
So ClickText is my website development, operations coordinator. I'm over there.
Yeah, that's your full time?
That's my full time.
Okay.
Right? The same person that owns ClickText single-handedly also owns FranchiseSoft. That's a CRM. It's for franchisees, you know, franchise leads management. I think I told you about that. And then, you know, obviously the business development executive I'm doing for Archisys.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm focusing a lot on Archisys now because I know I have these jobs going anyways. I just 9 to 5, but Archisys is sales. I'm a sales guy.
Yeah.
I worked in Source actually. I'm not sure if you know that.
In what?
Source is like the Bell, you know Bell, right? It owns
The source.
I used to work there.
Okay.
So I'm a sales guy.
Yeah.
Right. So I think I took that experience and actually I'm applying it on all three.
Yeah, I respect that.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's great to hear, man. Well, cool. Archit, man, thank you for coming on and talking about this. We had a ton of time talking about India and the
India
different cultures.
India, you got all your myths clear, right?
Nothing more. Hopefully. Right. Hopefully. Again, I'm planning a visit there as well.
Yeah.
Right,
okay.
So I'll reach out to you for some local hangouts.
Sure.
Cool. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Perfect.